In my vision of the future, everything is accessible, including the digital world. Over 1 billion people in the world have disabilities, and a lot of us are online. Gaining access to online information can feel incredible. For me, when the web became available, I could go anywhere. I could study the science and technology, and I could travel all over the world of ideas. In the online world, we have a seemingly infinite amount of information available, but we're still putting barriers in front of some people. We can change that. You're probably familiar with the concept of accessibility from the physical world, the design of products and communications and environments so that they work for people with disabilities. If you picture a building and there's a flight of stairs going up to the entrance, not everyone can get up those stairs. But if you add a ramp, there's an accessible way in. But then, if you think of accessibility from the design stage forward, you could design a level, no-step entrance, and everyone could come in the front door. That's universal or inclusive design. I work on accessibility in the digital world, and I want to tell you about some things that can make it easier for everyone to use the web, including people with disabilities, and also things like building accessible virtual worlds. Here are some things that you can do on the web. If you have images or video and you embed descriptions, then everyone can access the information in those images, even if they cannot see well or see at all. If you add captions to audio, everyone can learn what's being said, even if they can't hear well or hear at all. If a website works well with voice recognition, then everyone can interact with that website, even if you can't use your hands. And if you design the navigation menus in a consistent way, then everyone can find their way around the site more easily, including people with intellectual disabilities or people who might have memory impairments, perhaps due to aging. Digital accessibility goes well beyond the web. It includes the design of mobile phones, online games, digital books, telepresence robots, and more. Digital accessibility enables us to capture the creative contributions of everyone, the Stephen Hawkings and the Stevie Wonders, as well as the creative contributions of more ordinary people with disabilities. So, how do we build an accessible world? What elements are most important? Awareness is a very important piece of the foundation. A colleague of mine invites all the new hires at the tech firm that he works at to come to the accessibility center that he has. And he surveys them to see who might have already heard about accessibility issues and technologies. As of a few years ago, it wasn't any more than 10% in any group of visitors that would come to the center. We have an awareness problem. There's a history of exclusion of people with disabilities going back centuries, millennia. And it's only gradually starting to change. And some disabilities are not necessarily visible, such as hearing impairments. And so awareness of disabilities is actually much lower than the reality. And many people, including people who design technologies, haven't gotten a lot of exposure to this dimension of human variation. And ironically, we then go and design technologies and environments that are inaccessible and that perpetuate that exclusion. We could be teaching people about the diverse user needs when we prepare people for careers in engineering and design. So awareness is one thing. Rights are another very important element. The United Nations Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities has been ratified by 177 countries. That's an international consensus. And it establishes important rights such as access to education and to civic participation and more, including accessibility of information and communications technologies. And around the world, many governments have laws and regulations that require web accessibility and accessibility of other technologies. But sometimes getting people to implement accessibility feels like the hardest part. So I want to tell you a story back in the physical world for a minute. I ran into a friend a few years after the Americans with Disabilities Act had been passed in 1990. She was a longtime advocate for accessible transportation, and I asked her, enjoying finally having our civil rights? It seemed like a safe question to ask, but she said no. She said she'd been waiting at this bus stop, and a bus came by, but it didn't have a lift on it, so she couldn't get on. And then the second bus came by, and it had a lift, but it was broken. The third bus came by, and the driver said, well, I haven't had any training on how to use it yet. And the fourth bus came by, and the driver said, I'm running behind schedule. I don't have time to run this lift for you. And the fifth bus just zoomed right past her. And so there were some teens who had been watching her for a few hours as she was waiting, and they came over and mugged her. So in the physical world, inaccessibility has consequences. The bus company was aware, and my friend had rights, but something went wrong in the implementation, and accessibility didn't happen. Implementation also matters in the digital world. So a lot of times, products get shipped without the accessibility bugs fixed. And sometimes critical new accessibility features get postponed to the next version and the next version and the next version. Blind friends tell me that one of the most frustrating things is they will go all the way through filling out an online form and they'll go to hit that submit button to confirm, and that button wasn't coded right to work with the screen reading technology that they rely on. And what if that button was at the bottom of an online job application and you really needed that job? Or what if you're deaf in a rural area and you need to talk with a specialist over a telemedicine platform? And what if nobody got around to figuring out how to integrate captions into that telemedicine platform? Implementation matters. Here's the good news. Digital accessibility is getting better. Tech firms are starting to declare accessibility as a public commitment. Some are starting to appoint chief accessibility officers so that accessibility is considered in management decisions. Accessibility bugs are sometimes getting showstopper status, meaning fix the bugs before you ship the product. And accessibility is sometimes being included as part of corporate social responsibility, and inclusive design is increasingly getting recognized as an innovation driver. And we're starting to see some exciting accessible products and services as a result of all of this. So there's another thing that's changing as well. There's a lot more resources to explain how to make technology accessible. Think of an online shopping site for a moment, and let's say that all the items on sale are only differentiated by the color red. Now, there's a lot of people who have color blindness, and they're not going to be able to tell, just from that one distinction, which items are on sale. So what our group does is we develop guidelines, and we have an internationally recognized standard called the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines that explains how to fix that, as well as many, many other things that are covered in that. And what you can do is you can add a bit of text or some kind of icon to indicate, give a redundant indication of what was indicated in the color. And then people can make their choices and buy what they want to. Another thing that those guidelines do, remember the confirm or the submit problem that I mentioned a few minutes ago, it will tell you how to code that in a way that will work regardless of the assistive technology that a person with disability might be using with your website. And that way, everyone can apply for that job. We have a lot of different introductory materials as well as more technical materials that explain how to make technologies accessible. And another thing that's changed is that there is this large international community, a wonderful community, that includes people from industry and the disability community and research and government, building this expanding set of resources that explain how to make technologies accessible. And this is causing a ripple effect through the whole field. One of my favorite things is looking at the possibilities of advanced tools and technologies to make accessibility easier to design and develop, and sometimes to even improve on the accessibility in the physical world. Let me give you a few examples of the possibilities. Some people get a seizure reaction from photographic flash or strobing lights. Now, if you were to combine machine learning, which is a type of artificial intelligence or AI, with video processing, you can analyze the variations, the fluctuations in the brightness, and you can buffer that before it's displayed on a computer screen or a wearable headset, thus reducing the seizure risk. For people with color blindness, or more properly, atypical color perception, you can analyze the colors in a video stream and you can shift them to colors that are more readily perceived by an individual. And some people on the autism spectrum have difficulty recognizing emotions in people's facial expressions. And so you can use machine learning to analyze those emotions and to tag the video stream. Once you start thinking in terms of accessibility, you may see opportunities everywhere. Think of automatic speech recognition. The quality of that, the accuracy of recognition, has improved immensely. We're using it on our mobile phones and our digital assistants. It's not quite at a level of accuracy yet that works for fully reliable captions. But one of the things that's still quite difficult in speech recognition is recognizing the speech of people, of some people who are deaf, and the speech of some people with speech disabilities. And artificial intelligence can also help us there because it's better at recognizing some of the subtle patterns. And so that will eventually enable us to more equitably transcribe and caption the speech of people with different types of speech. A colleague, though, has noticed that there's some interesting issues that come up with artificial intelligence and disabilities. You've probably heard of AI bias around, for instance, racial and gender characteristics. Well, similar things can happen with disabilities. And she was looking at speech recognition and noticed that particularly the speech of people with speech disabilities, and she noticed that the accuracy of recognition was declining when the size of the reference data set was expanding, because the recognition was weighted more strongly towards the average pronunciations. And then she started looking at autonomous vehicles, self-driving cars, and she was testing how well these were trained against different simulated obstacles that might be crossing the street in front of a car. And she took video of people with certain kinds of wheelchair users. And she found that the simulated cars were hitting the simulated wheelchair users. And so she experimented with different transformations of this reference data set. And she found she had to do very radical transformations to the data set, not just amplifying the outliers, the less frequent data samples, but actually taking out the entire central core of the database before she could successfully train these vehicles not to hit the simulated wheelchair users. So advanced technologies can help us design accessible environments if we use them mindfully. And back to that thing I mentioned earlier about creating accessible virtual worlds. Think of all the different senses and information across all the different functional capabilities with different kinds of disabilities that you might be able to take advantage of. For instance, a haptic output that includes vibrational effects, and that includes a gravity well, that kind of pulling sensation you can get in space. There's always different kind of modalities you can rely on to help make technologies accessible, and in doing so, to make environments that work better for everyone. So when I talk about digital accessibility, a lot of times people feel like there's nothing that they can do. I want to challenge that. Sometimes it's a simple matter of looking at a situation and thinking, have people thought about accessibility? Have people considered that? And asking questions. For instance, the school website. There's probably parents who have disabilities and want to be able to catch up with the school events. And if your town has online emergency preparedness training materials and an emergency notification system, that's life or death information. How about we all make sure that that's accessible? In the physical world, there's still ongoing work to make everything accessible. It takes many hands. Given the pace, the accelerating pace of technology change, we need even more hands at the table on accessibility. So that means that all of the tech courses, all of the science labs, the maker spaces where you can fabricate 3D objects, all need to be accessible. And in making those accessible, we'll probably come up with some interesting new innovations as well. So if you're a mobile app developer, you can build accessible apps. Anywhere you work in the tech or science field, there's a role that you have where you can help. If you're a quality assurance tester, you can get the tools and the training to test for accessibility. If you're a developer with a disability in a country with no accessibility businesses yet, you can be the first one to open a business. If you're a manager, you can prioritize inclusive design as an innovation driver, but you can also ensure a reliable baseline of accessibility of all your products and services. If you're a recruiter, you can pursue inclusive hiring, including at the management and board levels, so that accessibility is considered among other aspects of diversity in improving everything you do. And if you speak multiple languages, you can help us get the word out around the world. I want to welcome you to join us in building an accessible digital future, and particularly in asking questions when you notice places where others might not have thought of accessibility. Thank you.